Today we light the candle of love. Join me in our candle lighting liturgy. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned.
It is the light of love, embodied in Jesus Christ, the King of love.
In love, God denied his godliness to join us as Jesus, an ordinary baby.
In love, Jesus sat with rejected outcasts and despised sinners alike.
In love, Jesus laid down his life to atone for our sin.
In love, Jesus rose from the dead to restore us to life.
Basking in Christ's love, we light the fourth Advent candle. Thanks be to God. Now we're going to teach you a new song this morning, and it stems around. So we're going to break you up into four groups in just a moment. But first, Candace and I will teach you the song. So I'm going to sing it through once, and then invite you to join me along as we practice it. So,
prepare the way of the Lord. Prepare the way of the Lord, and all people will see the salvation of our God.
Let's try that together.
Prepare the way of the Lord. Prepare the way of the Lord, and all people will see the salvation of our God.
So we're going to break up into fours. I'll take group one. And I'm sorry to do this, Kathy and Renee, but we're going to divide it right there. Oh, center line. See the center line? Right there. So Ross will form group two, and Bev on that way. And group three here, and group four. So follow me. We're going to sing it through once together. And then group one will start, and we'll bring in group two, okay?
Thank you.
As God has blessed us, let's return our offerings to God now. Let's pray. Loving God, we give you thanks for being here this morning. We give you thanks for the gifts that we are able to lay upon the table. We give you thanks for the gifts that we are able to share beyond this place. We give you thanks most of all for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, for the way he transformed our lives, for the way he introduced something new to the world, a new way to understand you, a new way to see our relationship with you, a new way to live. As we gather before you this morning, we recognize the love with which you sent Jesus, the way you made love become flesh, the way you turn that heavenly love that provides for us our daily needs into something that feeds our hearts. We give you thanks for this love, God. And we ask that you help us to come before you with that same love. We ask that you help us to get rid of our prejudices and selfishness, that you help us to set aside our pettiness and malice, that you forgive us, that you take away our sin, that you take away our shame and guilt, and that you fill us with hearts to love and hands to express that love. As we have gathered before you, we recognize the tremendous gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, the gift of your Holy Spirit flowing through us, the gift of yourself ruling over us, being with us. We pray that as we worship you, our songs, our words, our thoughts will be worthy of you, and that as we leave this place of worship later on, that our actions will be a gift to the world. We offer this in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and we say together, Amen. I'm going to invite Janice to share the word.
First reading is from Luke chapter 18, verses 35 to 43. As Jesus approached Jericho, a blind man was sitting by the roadside begging. When he heard the crowd going by, he asked, "What was happening?" They told him, "Jesus of Nazareth is passing by." He called out, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." Those who led the way rebuked him and told him to be quiet. But he shouted all the more, "Son of David, have mercy on me." Jesus stopped and ordered the man to be brought to him. When he came near, Jesus asked him, "What do you want me to do for you?" "Lord, I want to see," he replied. Jesus said to him, "Receive your sight. Your faith has healed you." Immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus, praising God. When all the people saw it, they also praised God. Next reading is from 1 John chapter 4, verses 7 to 10. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins.
Thank you, Janice. And now it's my great pleasure to turn the pulpit over to Bill Clark and Ike as he talks about pet therapy.
Morning.
Good morning.
I'm not really a pet therapist. I'm just a guy that God brought a dog to, so I figured, well, when John asked me to come, that I have to bring Ike views to talk about pet therapy. My daughter put this presentation together, and before I left the house this morning, she told me, "Now, you're not supposed to talk specifics just about Ike. You're supposed to talk about pet therapy in general. So you'll have to bear with me, please." And also, as they say, behind every good man, there's an even better woman. Well, that's my wife, and she's at home. All right, thank you. Okay, so as you see up on the screen, it was one of the first things that God had done was to create animals. Okay, if you want to move on to slide 2 now. And animals have been used since the beginning of time. From there, we'll move on to slide 3. Oh, I think we're too far on. There should be one, one before that. There should be one of a German Shepherd, and he was our first dog. Go ahead, we can go ahead and do that. And as the slides come up, I'll just explain. This is our second dog. We called her Jess. And after the first dog we had, when I was up north, I only lasted about a week after we had to have him put down with no dog, and we ended up with her. I took her to dog school in Wallaceburg. She went for 10 courses. And she ended up at the end of the course, she would have taken first place, but there was a dog that was supposed to be a show dog, so they give her first place. So she would make sure that I got out on the bicycle regularly and would ride the bike, and I'd go running, and she was good for our family. Really didn't get into the pet therapy thing with her, but she was just a good girl to have around, okay? Now, this is on the left, this is Ike when he was a pup. He got him for Father's Day and my birthday in about 2011. And then the one on the right is him now. Now, I've taken him to school here in Chatham at PetSmart. But they have a very good program there. What they do is, you can go through the different stages of training. He's only had the first stage, so I can really say that this is God at work. What they do at the store is you go through the program and you get to go throughout the store. And it's just amazing how the dogs walk throughout the store and people just come in off the street and they can pet the dogs. And it's just amazing. In this past summer, we took them to a dog event in London called Palooza. There's thousands of dogs there, and they all get along. There's all kinds of people selling like dog food, pet supplies, and everything. And it's just amazing how all these dogs are there and get along. And you can walk up to anybody's dog, and they're just so friendly. Okay, the next one. Okay, and this is the benefits of pet therapy. Like I say, we take them to Park Street every week. Initially, I had been trying to get involved with the St. John's Ambulance program, and I think what it was with God telling me it's not time yet, because we had gone without a dog for a couple of years, and then I ended up with him for Father's Day and my birthday. Again, we tried to get the St. John's Ambulance program going again in Dresden. We never got anywhere, and then again I thought, well, it must not be time. So then finally I decided, well, I'll call Park Street my home, see if they'll let us go in and visit the residents. Contacted them, gave them the paperwork and everything, and the event coordinator said, sure, bring them. So I just took them in, and we started visiting the residents. My daughter takes them now every week, and he's been going there regularly for the past 6 months. It's just, if you never had to know, don't do this, don't do that. We just took him in, and like I say, he's been going ever since. And also, like it says up there, increased mobility, and you can see it in the people's faces. We've got some shots of video we took this past Wednesday, and the sound's not all the best, but you can tell by the video that it's just amazing what he can do. Okay? On to the next slide. Okay. Like it says, any pet can be a part of pet therapy. And any pet can sit with a person and do some amazing stuff. All right. Now, Ike, he does this at home, but it's when I'm on the couch. And he only does it with me. He'll climb up on my lap like that. When he was about 6 months old, he got very sick. He ended up, you can still see the scar on his forehead here. There was a bump about the size of a golf ball. I took him to the vet in Dresden, and they said at that time that they didn't know if he was going to pull through or not. They gave him some medication and x-rays, did some tests. And they said it wasn't cancer, but they didn't know if he was going to pull through or not. Well, went on for a couple weeks, and for that couple weeks he'd be sitting up on my lap and we'd sit there for hours. Well, now it still continues on. I'll sit and watch TV and he'll spend hours up on my lap. We often have our suppers downstairs in the basement watching TV, and at times he'll try and beat me downstairs so that he can get the spot on the couch. Not very often does he ever sit where my wife sits. He figures that his spot is my spot, I guess. Okay, the next one. Okay, and this is the different types of therapy with pets. Okay. Okay. And now, this is another story. We have fish at home in a pond. We have koi. We have goldfish too. The koi are just amazing. We got one, he's about 7 years old now, he's about this long. A couple years ago, I got into the pond when he was just a pup, and he must have saw a frog or something, because we ended up with a hole in the liner, and we had rocks on the side of the pond, and the rocks had been moved, and we ended up having to take the fish across to our neighbors, because they have a pond. We took four of the big ones over there, and I saw the guy about a week later, he says, you're not getting your fish back. He says, they're just amazing. He says, they're doing all kinds of tricks and everything. Well, the one, the big koi, we call Gold Digger, he'll swim on his back in order to get food. And then it talks here about even llama therapy. Okay. And just because your people can't go out and visit others, doesn't mean that they're not doing therapy for you. Okay. Now this one talks about the different visitation animals and where they can go. Like I was saying earlier about getting them certified with the St. John's Ambulance Program, it's a great program. And you're fall under their insurance coverage, so if anything was to happen, they were to bite somebody or somebody get injured, well then you're covered. With his nature and the way he is, I'm comfortable with taking him just on this leash. And by doing that, if somebody was to call me and say, could you bring him over so I could visit him, I can do that. Whereas with the St. John's Ambulance Program, you have to have the supervisor go in and check the place out. And they don't usually go into houses, but they'll go into hospitals and retirement homes. And after they're in the program for a couple of years, then they can go into libraries and schools. But until that time, they can't go. But like I say, somebody could call and just say, could you bring them over? And then they can go. But I wouldn't feel comfortable in just taking the leash off and letting them run around, because then you never know what can happen. There's still that potential. Okay, and this is the video that we took this past Wednesday. This fellow's the manager at Park Street Retirement Home. Okay, so if you want to run that for me, please. You might have to click on the run it itself. All else will call home.
And just drag the mouse right on it. There it is, down. Cool.
No, just back.
I'm in with my talk. I'm the general manager of Park Street Place. One of the things that the residents really enjoy about Kelly is the stories that they hear about all of the things that Meg has done over his life and his growing up. And every time they get a chance to see him, the smiles light up on their face, and they absolutely enjoy every minute of it. It's a very positive experience, and I know they look forward to seeing him every week on his face.
Thank you, Andrew.
You're very welcome.
Great.
And what does it mean to have Ike come visit you? What does it mean to you to have Ike come visit?
Makes your day.
Yes, it certainly does. I enjoy seeing you. I've never seen a dog like you.
Okay, and when I come to visit,
I would just like to know what it means to have a dog come visit.
Oh, it means a lot. Yeah, I love animals, and it's great to have them come in and you can actually pet them. Yeah, it's wonderful.
Okay.
Well, I don't know what he does
I think that must be it. There should be one more slide at the very end. Can you follow right to the end? Okay, this one, your backup one, if you could run that one. I spent a week in the hospital a couple weeks ago.
In the hospital?
Could you just stop it? I was very sick. I was within hours of having a major operation. And I think knowing that he was at home must have helped, because it was within a couple days the doctor said, well, you're not going to need the operation. You're in pretty good health. You might as well go home. So I hadn't seen him for a week. If it was summertime, I would imagine my daughter would have tried to get him to come to the hospital, because this time of year, and that's when we were having all the snow and everything, where were they going to take him so that I could visit with him, because I had an IV in me and everything. Okay, so you want to run it now? So now, they just brought him home. He doesn't know I'm home, but we know that he knows something's going on.
Yeah, you know something's going on? What's
going on? Now he sees me. Now I guess you figure it's time to go.
Thank you.
just want to thank Bill once again for being here this morning. And you heard a bit of the story earlier on. We're afraid Bill wouldn't be able to be here because he was facing a surgery. And I didn't hear all of the story, but you didn't have to have a surgery after all. So what a blessing, what a miracle, and we thank God for that. And it was wonderful to have you here and to meet Ike. Ike, you have been a very good boy, very patient. I know you know what we're talking about. And Bill rightly pointed out that it is God that indeed does the healing, not the pets themselves. And yet in my research, Bill didn't mention that there is scientific research that talks about and proves what animals do. And one of the things that Bill mentioned about, you know, the feeling better, there are two things that actually happen to your brain when pets are coming to help out. One is the release of serotonin, which is the feel-good hormone, which it's simply a reaction. When a pet comes in for whatever reason, there is this natural reaction that we have to feel pleasure at the presence of an animal. The other one is one that's a little harder for science to explain. They don't actually have a hormone name, but the effect is called mirroring. Very simple concept to understand. That is, we mirror the mood of the people or the animals that come into our presence. Now, one of the things about trained animals like Ike is that they're in a good mood. They're in a good mood when they come in. They want to meet people. First thing Ike did was he came up to me, and you know how dogs sort of look at you and they're trying to figure you out, and there's that pleasure that they have in meeting you. It's like, hey, how you doing? Nice to see you. And we mirror that. So not only do we have this feel-good hormone coming out and making us feel better automatically, but also we pick up on the signals, which is why so often how you feel when you go into a place makes a big difference. You go into that job interview and you're sullen and upset, and the interviewer is going to pick up on that and is going to react to you. If your sullen and upset is stronger than his happy and cheerful, guess how your interview is going to go. So pets do this for us. But it is God's work. For the past 4 weeks, we've been exploring how this healing takes place in different ways, through different people. We had Candace talk about music therapy. We talked about Community Living Chatham Kent and how they help with mental health. We had our naturopathic doctor come and talk about the work that they do. Today we met Ike and Bill and we heard about pet therapy. But it is God himself who does the healing. And today we heard the story of Jesus curing a blind beggar. Now, there are a couple of factors in that story that are very important. The beggar, against all odds, approached Jesus. And so we see one of the first things that's important about our healing. And that is, yes, God can do it. Yes, Jesus can heal us. But we have to want to be healed. Did you ever think about that? You actually have to desire to be healed. And I know that sometimes we're caught up in our pain and our misery and we wish it would go away. We wish that the pain would stop, that the bone would heal, that the cancer would disappear. But we don't engage in that wish always. Our prayers are, if it's your will, God, never just heal me. Our prayers are, oh, well, just give me the patience to bear up with it. Never, God, I want to be better. And I know it's a challenge. I know, especially as Presbyterians, and heaven help us, Canadian Presbyterians, we're polite. God, if you've got a minute, excuse me, I'm so sorry for interrupting your busy day, but if you've got a second, would you mind thinking about, considering, perhaps doing something about coming close to approaching a healing? The blind beggar just went up to Jesus and said, I need to have my sight back. And we're hesitant to do that. That's our human nature. But the invitation is there. To be an active part of our healing. Now, I'm not saying that each and every one of us is going to receive that instant miracle of the absolute cure. But I can guarantee pretty much that if we don't ask for it, if we aren't an active part in our healing, we're not going to get better. If we're not positive about our improvement, about feeling better, the results will not be positive. Time and again, when you read through the healings that take place in Scripture, it's the folks that are bold enough to go up and to say, please help. And that's not to say God won't intervene in our lives when we're incapable of asking for help, or we're too shy. But there's nothing wrong with being bold, with stepping forward and letting God know your needs. Because I think, well, if you listen to the key words, what is it that Jesus said about the man? What is it that Jesus said about the blind beggar that was a factor in his healing? Your boldness has healed you. No. Your mellifluous voice and well-phrased request was what healed you. My desire to get you out of my face right now was what healed you. Jesus says, your faith, your trust, your belief, your acceptance. And it's in that trust, it's in that faith that our healing takes place. God loves us. God wants us to be close to Him. God wants us to be well. God wants us to serve Him in ways that reflect that love. So when we talk about healing, the physical healing is important. But today when Janice read from 1 John, she talked about God's love. And God's love being manifested in Jesus. But she talked about that manifestation in a spiritual manner. Our healing coming through the atoning sacrifice. Jesus healing our souls. Jesus fixing our relationship with God. That is the single most important healing we can have. To be right with God. Our physical healing, our physical states, I've talked about this before, is almost irrelevant. Not that it doesn't count. When you're in pain, it's hard to have faith. I understand that. But without that forgiveness, without having the barrier of sin removed from our lives, without our spirits being whole and strong, it's impossible to have faith. It's almost impossible to trust God when you approach God and your first words are, I'm embarrassed to be here because of my sin. I'm embarrassed to be here because of what I've done to my neighbor. I'm ashamed of what I've said or the person I've become. So God makes it possible for us to get rid of that and to come boldly to Him and say, I trust you, I love you, thank you for getting rid of my sins so that I can be here in your presence, so that I can be worthy to be here, so that I can feel your love. That is what God's love does for us. That is the healing that matters. But there's one slight condition. Even in this kind of healing, Jesus did it for us without our asking. He did it for us because we needed it, but ultimately, what do we have to do when we want that forgiveness? We have to confess our sins and ask for it. We have to boldly go before God and not say, well, you know, if you got a minute, when you're not doing something else more important, would you think about forgiving me? We're invited to go boldly and say, God, I know you love me. Please forgive me for what I did just now, or last week, or in my life, or whatever it is we need forgiveness for. But he asks us to do that boldly, to share that love. And when we share that love, when we are spiritually whole, when we are able to go to our God and say, God, I need your forgiveness, God. I need your help, God. I need your healing. Then an amazing thing happens. Not only do we take part in our healing, but as I've tried to demonstrate over the past few weeks, we, in our own way, whether it's through music therapy or working with the mental health services in town or being a professional doctor, naturopathic or traditional, being a nurse, being a therapist of some kind, or whether it's working with pets, we are invited into healing others, into that process of making others feel better. Now, probably 90% of you here are not trained professional healers, right? We have a few nurses in our midst. I don't think we have any therapists other than Bill and I. So you're saying, well, how can I heal somebody? We do, I'm sorry, we have Candace on, sorry. Candace isn't here regularly, so she's not built into my regular. But we do have a music therapist, so we do have a therapist. But the rest of us don't necessarily have skills that we can identify. Say, Pastor John, I'm not a trained professional in any of these aspects. But I ask you, how many of you know the amazing power of the smell of shortbread cookies? You know that power, right? Talk about the release of the feel-good hormones. Well, how many of you can bake a shortbread cookie? Come on! And the rest of you say, well, I can't bake shortbread cookies. How many of you can go to the corner store and buy a bag of shortbread cookies? Guess what? You have healing powers by being able to either bake them or simply deliver them. How many of you can say, hi, how are you doing? And have that question mean something? Right? Not the standard, hi, how you doing? You owe me money, right? But the hi, how are you doing? Pause, wait for an answer, listen to what the person says, and then respond accordingly. You can do that? If you can do that, you can take part in Christ's healing. Even if you are one of those folks who bumps into somebody and says, excuse me, I am so sorry, and you mean it, you have a part in God's healing power. So I invite you to do two things today. Oh no, we've got work to do. Yes. The first one is all about you. Accept the healing that God is willing to offer you if you ask for it. And the second is to share whatever gifts of healing that you have as freely as Jesus has shared them with you. And we say, Amen. Let's bow our heads together in prayer. loving God, it is in your power to heal us. We dare to seek that power now. Through Jesus Christ, we ask that you let your healing flow through us, working on us in ways that will not simply bless us, but bless you as well. We ask not simply for physical healing so that we can feel better, but for the soul deep healing that sets us right with you and with all humanity. As part of our healing, let us in turn be healers in our own way. Perhaps it's through the way we serve our community, working to bring light to darkened corners of despair. Perhaps it's by doing simple chores for those who can't do them on their own. Perhaps it's being a positive influence in a negative environment. Perhaps it's offering prayers when words or actions are beyond us. However it is that we can heal, let us know and let us go. Empower us to bring about the healing of those close to us. And through our Christ-like efforts as a congregation and a denomination, to bring about the healing of the nations that will bless all humanity. Hear us now as we offer our own thoughts and concerns in our private prayers. Thank you, God, for listening to our physical needs and our heartfelt desires. Now, God of mercy, we know that along with the physical woes that ail us, we are broken by the power of sin in our lives, both the sin that is our responsibility and the sins of others that have impacted our lives. We pray for your forgiveness and for the grace to forgive others for the pain they have caused us. Let your love flow through us to strengthen and encourage us. Let your wisdom flow into us to equip us and guide us. Let your power flow over us to motivate and drive us. Hear us, loving God, for we pray in the name of our Savior, Healer, Redeemer, and Friend, your one and only Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Please rise for our benediction. May the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, and the healing power of Christ himself be with you today and forevermore. And with one voice we say, Amen.
Yeah, it's about that.
No.